Great are you, Lord, worthy of all praise. Great are you, Lord, Jesus, you are. Great are you, Lord, holy, holy, holy. Great are you, Lord, and worthy, worthy, worthy. Great are you, Lord. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name. Every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety. To every soul held captive by darkness over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
praise this morning. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
We worship you, God.
Over every heart and every mind. Because I know there is peace within your presence. I seek Jesus.
Join me in prayer this morning. If you're watching today, join us as the church family. Lord, we come to you speaking the name of Jesus. We do not come to you this morning, Lord, in the name of any church or in the name of any pastor or any other name. We come in the name of Jesus. We come in the name that is above every name. And so, Lord, we come bringing our needs to you this morning. Lord, I pray for everyone in your house, Lord. I pray for the Crossroads family watching online today, Lord. Wherever the need is, wherever the hurt is, wherever the suffering is, Lord, in Jesus' name, Lord, we speak, God, your healing. In Jesus' name, we speak, Lord, your strength, your encouragement, your life. I pray for anyone here, Lord, that is hurting emotionally, God, that is racked with fear, Lord, and worry, God. In Jesus' name, Lord, we receive your freedom from those things. Lord, for anyone hurting, God, physically, we receive the strengthening touch of the one who heals in Jesus' name. Anyone hurting financially, Lord, teach us your way to walk. Because, God, you promised abundance, Lord, when we follow your way. I pray, God, for every relationship in your house this morning. I pray for every family in the Crossroads family, for every marriage, for relationships among friends, at work, at school, church. Lord, we speak your love to those relationships right now. We speak your love, God, to those relationships. Lord, I think of things going on in our nation and across the world. Lord, I pray again, your will be done, your plan unfold, and protect your people in the Middle East today. I pray for Acapulco, Mexico, Lord, and the hurricane and the resulting flooding, and Lord, the 30-plus people, Lord, that lost their lives in that tragedy in Acapulco, Lord. I pray especially this morning for those in Lewiston, Maine, across the country, Lord, and the 18 families that are grieving and the many that have been injured, Lord, through this past week. I pray your peace to those grieving, those who are lost. I pray your strength for those that are grieving today. Lord, I thank you within our church family that you are continuing to strengthen and to lift up, Lord. Daryl Harrington, Lord, you just poured your healing into his body after surgery. We thank you for that. For Jan Collins, you're continuing to strengthen her, Lord. And for many others in our church family, we receive your touch, your life, your strength. In Jesus' name, we pray it all this morning. Amen. Can we sing that one more time? Sing it to Jesus this morning.
Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is love.
Break every stronghold,
break every stronghold,
shine,
shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is love.
Break every stronghold,
break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire.
Hallelujah. Believe God answers prayer this morning. Amen. So do I. As you're being seated, turn to somebody, tell them God heard your prayer. Go ahead and tell them that this morning. Mentioned our head usher, Pastor Daryl Harrington. He does pastor camera. Say, Daryl, you're at home. I just gave you a promotion. No, that's right. He's doing well. Many of you have been asking about it. He's been our head usher for many years, and he's doing great after open heart surgery, right? There's a couple of big cards at the info center. Encourage you to sign them on your way out. We're going to get them with Daryl. He'll get a kick out of that. So keep praying. We're hoping within maybe 2 Sundays he'll be able to come back just to watch, right? We're not going to let him work. So if you see him working, you just say, Daryl, have a seat, okay? But keep praying for him. He's doing great, all right? We're going to pray over our giving this morning. And as we always say, if you're here for the first time, so glad you found us. If you're tuning in on Facebook or YouTube or our Crossroads LV app, so glad you found us there. Don't feel any pressure to give. You're our guest this morning. We're grateful for everyone who considers this church their home. They support this ministry. Let's pray over the giving. Lord, thank you so much for your blessings in our lives. Jesus, we give back to you as an act of obedience and faith, God, to your word and your command, Lord, that brings your blessings and your abundance into our lives. So we just give with joy this morning in Jesus' name. Amen.
Welcome to Crossroads Church, where you belong.
We'd like to thank you for your generous giving. If you'd like to give today, there are 4 different ways that you can do that. You can send a check to the address that you see below. You can send a text to the phone number that you see below. You can go to our website, crossroadschurch.vegas/give, or on your way out today, you can drop it in the offering box. You may have noticed when you came in this morning, there was this Connect card sitting in the seat back in front of you. If this is your first time with us or your first time in a while, we'd love for you to go ahead and fill one of these out so we can get to know you just a little bit better. And for those of you watching online, there is a link in the description below that you can click that'll take you to this as well.
We've had so much fun this past week at Messy Monday and Movie Night. Take a look back at these pictures and see all the fun we had. To ratify the 2024 budget and new board members.
Don't forget, next Sunday, November 5th, we are fall back. So make sure you set those clocks back an hour. We want to see you here at church at 10 a.m.
Hey, if you haven't downloaded our app, look up Crossroads Church LV, download our app and be able to follow us, whether it's fillable notes as Pastor has his sermons or old sermons, as well as connecting with us in anything that's happening here at Crossroads Church, go to your app store and look for Crossroads Church LV.
Have a blessed week!
All right, well, today is part 2 of a series we just started last week, and you can always access past messages at our app and on our website. But today we're talking about how to overcome worry, stress, and fear, and part 2 is God's promise that destroys worry, stress, and fear in your life. Because I don't know about you, I grew up in a household that was a good household, it was a great household, but my dad was a major worrier. All right, if there is such a thing as a worry hall of fame, he's in it, okay? And I kind of like got that from him, you know? And God has just set me free over the years. I mean, I still worry occasionally, right? Who doesn't? But he's really set me free over the years. And this whole series, these 6 Sundays, is about sharing with you some strategies and some biblical truths about how you can overcome worry, stress, and fear in your life. How many have worried this month about anything or this week, right? Yeah, we all have, right? It's natural. You can't live in this world and not stress out, right? That's why the other thing I've done is I try to stay current, but I've reduced the amount of news I watch. If you sit around and watch news nonstop, you're gonna worry. Mr. Rogers would be worried. You know, you're just gonna worry, right? So we're going to talk about some things today that'll set you free from worrying, because worrying can rob you of your joy. It'll rob you of your peace. You'll forfeit God's best for your life if you let worry build a foundation of stress and fear in your life. So God has better for you. God wants to set you free from those things, and that's what we're going to talk about today. There's a great promise that God made to his people Israel found in Isaiah chapter 41 and verse 10 is our text this morning, and it's for all believers. Paul taught that, you know, if you're a believer, if you're a Christ follower, if through faith in Christ you become born again, we are all a part of Israel. So this promise is for us as well. Let's look at the text this morning, Isaiah 41 and verse 10. Matter of fact, can we just say it out loud together? Let's do it. Do not fear, for I am with you, says the Lord. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. The first thing we see in this text, and you got your notes in your bulletin, you're watching online, you can get them at our website, is God's presence eliminates fear and worry. God's presence eliminates fear and worry. Now, first of all, when we talk about fear today, we're talking about negative fear. We're talking about dark fear, because there is such a thing as good fear, right? There's natural fear of danger, right, that keeps you from crossing a busy street, you know, when there's all kinds of cars. You know, that's a good fear. The Bible talks about the fear of the Lord. That's a good fear. What's the fear of the Lord? The fear of the Lord is a fear that acknowledges the awesomeness of God, that takes God seriously and says, God, I'm going to take you seriously in what you say in your word. The fear of the Lord's a good fear. We're not talking about those things today. We're talking about negative fear. We're talking about dark fear that causes stress and worry and entangles our lives and causes us to doubt and just to live, right, in that kind of way, in that kind of burden. That's the kind of fear we're talking about, negative fear. In our text, Isaiah says, do not fear, says the Lord, for I am with you. The term fear is the Hebrew word yare, and it's the emotion of fear or distress. It means to be demoralized, to be terrified. It's the anticipation of evil. The fear that comes when you get laid off from your job. What are we going to do now, right? The fear that comes when the test results come back and that tumor is malignant. The fear that comes when you get that phone call that says your son or your daughter has been in a car accident. This is the kind of fear that can demoralize you. God says to us, do not fear. You don't need to live in that kind of emotion. You don't need to be terrified and demoralized by fear. The word demoralized literally means to destroy the morale of someone, to weaken, to be drained of courage. The word fear here, yare in the Hebrew, is also connected to a Hebrew word yara, which means to pour out. Demoralizing fear causes your strength to be drained or poured out of you. That's why sometimes, and maybe you've seen this in movies or something, or hopefully you haven't experienced it, but you know, when somebody gets devastating news, they can faint or they can collapse, right? That's why somebody, are you sitting down? You know, because it just drains the strength right out of you. Demoralizing fear, it disrupts your life. It keeps you from sleeping. It keeps you from, you know, functioning, because all you can do is think about that worry, that fear, that problem. Yare, fear, means the anticipation of evil. How many get locked into that, the what ifs? I do sometimes, right? You get some news that on the surface isn't that bad, but all of a sudden, what if? What if this? What if that? What if this happens? What if this doesn't happen that I need it? What if we can't make it? What if I get sick? What if the car breaks down? What if I lose our medical? What if my child gets into drugs? What if, what if, what if? And your stomach starts to churn, you get that knot in there, right? Yare, fear, in the Hebrew grammar, is in the imperfect mood. How many Hebrew grammarians are here? The imperfect mood expresses an action or condition that's unfinished, that frequently repeats. So what's he talking about? That's the word fear. It's in the imperfect mood. It keeps going. It keeps repeating. In other words, the churning in your mind that doesn't stop. the thoughts that seem to take over your mind. You think about that problem over and over again. If you're like me, when you get into a cycle of worry, right, you can just start worrying about this thing. Before you know it, 15 minutes has gone by. Before you know it, 30 minutes has gone by. You say, what have I been doing? I'm just like worrying. You know, this thing goes over. That's the kind of fear we're talking about. That's why the Apostle John said this in 1 John 4:18. Fear has to do with punishment. Kolossos in the Greek, which literally means torment. The kind of fear that punishes and torments your life and your mind. The debilitating fear. But God says, I've got better for you. God says, I can set you free from that. And the big question is how? How? By recognizing the settled fact that God is with you. Isaiah starts out and he says, fear not. God says, for I am with you. If you'll remind yourself of that, if you'll get a hold of that with all of your heart, that God is with you, fear has to flee. God is with you. Turn to somebody and tell them, God is with you right now. Go ahead and tell them. So they can't, Pastor Bob, I don't know that person. That's all right. Audience participation is optional as always, right? God is with you. That's the antidote. That's what exterminates fear. Exterminate, worry exterminator number one. Meditate on the fact that God is with you. You need to meditate on the presence of God. As soon as you get that bad news, as soon as you get that worrying phone call, the first reaction should be, instead of what if, it should be, God, you're with me. You're still with me. You need to meditate on that. We talk about biblical meditation all the time. What's biblical meditation? It's not meditation that you kind of think of where you just kind of sit cross-legged and, you know, focus on your navel or something. It's not anything like that. Biblical meditation is thinking about God's word, the scriptures, God's word of promise, God thoughts over and over in your mind. You see, if you're a worrier, you're going to be great at biblical meditation because you already meditate. Did you know that? You didn't know that. You're just meditating in all the negative. That's what worrying is. It's meditating. It's going over and over about all the bad news, all the negative, all the dark stuff. Biblical meditation changes that, and instead you start thinking over and over about God's truth, about God's word of promise. God, through the prophet Isaiah, said, do not fear, for I am with you. And you begin to talk to yourself. I like talking to myself. I like talking to intelligent people. No, I like, you got to talk to yourself and say, God, you are with me. God, you are with me. I am not alone in this. I am not alone. God, you are not surprised by this. Lord, you are with me. You talk to yourself and you affirm God's life-giving word of promise. The two word pictures that are used about biblical meditation in the ancient world, number one word picture is a cow chewing its cud. There you go. Getting all the nutrients out of that, right? Then swallowing it, then bringing it back up again, right? Make you hungry, right? Everybody ready for brunch, right? The second word picture is a dog gnawing on a bone. How many have a dog? Any doggy owners here? I got a little dog, right? You ever see that dog gnaw on that bone, right? He's just gnawing on that thing. And my dog can gnaw on a bone not even for days, for weeks. You know, it's like, is there anything left on this thing, right? And he'll just gnaw on that thing and just work that thing, getting every flavor out of that bone. That's a word picture that's used in the ancient world for meditation, where you gnaw on that truth. God, you were with me. God, you were with me. The Almighty is with me. God, you are with me. You are with me right now, this moment. You are with me. You are with me. You are with me. And you gnaw on that and you meditate on that truth. You see, God's presence transcends your feelings. God's presence in your life is not predicated upon your feelings or your circumstances. You see, when everything's going great, You just got that raise and your wife thinks you're the greatest thing in the world and the kids are all getting straight A's and everything's going well and the sun is shining and you're getting all kinds of things. You know, it's easy to say, yes, God is with me. Everything's going my way. But when you're feeling down, when you're feeling low, when you're having struggles, when you're having doubts, it's easy to forget that God is with you. But his presence doesn't change. His presence is not predicated on what you feel or don't feel. His presence is not predicated on how many likes or dislikes you get online or in social media. His presence is not predicated upon, you know, what your friends at school or work or whatever think of you or don't think of you. You know, we give permission to all of these things on social media to determine how I'm going to feel today. You can stop doing that. Disconnect from that. Sure, we all want to be liked. But God's presence and love for you is not dictated or predicated upon any of those things. Whatever your situation, whatever you're going through, God's truth stands fixed in the universe. Isaiah said it, do not fear because God is with you. Sometimes as a Christian, as a Christ follower, you're born again through faith in Jesus. You might feel like you're alone. Have you ever felt alone? And it doesn't matter if you're married or single. It doesn't matter if you work around a lot of people or you're in a crowded room. You can be in a crowded room and still feel alone. I have. I don't know if anybody else has. And you know, when we first get saved, when we first receive Christ as Savior, boy, I felt his presence every day. It's like I just felt that God's with me. And then as I matured and grew up in God, there have been times I feel like I'm all alone in this. And I had to, by faith, depend on that truth. What's God doing? He's growing you up, right? You think of little babies, you know, we still have our grandson, little Jonas, with us for a couple days, 18 months old. You know, little babies, when they're in their crib and mom's in the room, they're all happy. Mom might step out for 2 seconds to grab a, you know, a wipe or something, and baby starts crying. Why? Because for a baby, when mom leaves the room, mom is gone from his life. But as the baby gets older, the toddler and the elementary, you know, as the baby matures, he realizes mom's coming back. Mom hasn't left me forever. She just popped out of the room for a second. That's part of maturity. God does the same thing for us. It's a settled fact. It's a truth. God, through the prophet, said, fear not. Do not be afraid. Because God is with you. That's the first thing you got to grab a hold of. The second point is this, number two in your outline. What you look at determines your state of mind. What you look at determines your state of mind. God through Isaiah said this in our text, do not be dismayed, God says, for I am your God. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. Your God. The word dismayed in the Hebrew is sha'ad. It means to be anxious. It means to look at, to gaze steadily with interest, to be in a state of great alarm and discouragement for the future. The basic idea is to look at in an intense way with fear. That's the word dismayed. You see, worry turns into fear when you continually look at your problem. Now, yes, we have to deal with our problems. Yes, you've got to find solutions to your struggles. Yes, you've got to take care of business. I'm not saying you just say, Pastor Bob says, I'm just going to sit in my apartment and just think happy thoughts and everybody will bring me money and food and jobs and all kinds of things. No, you've got to do your part. You've got to take care of business. But the term here for dismayed is not a casual glance. It's a look of intensity that creates worry and fear. And God says, be not dismayed. In other words, stop engulfing yourself in your problem. Do you know somebody that does that? Say, yeah, I'm sitting right next to him. Well, no pointing, okay? We don't want any, you know, fights breaking up. Stop immersing yourself in your worry thoughts. Stop talking about all the negatives in your challenge. Stop admiring your pain. Do you know anybody that does that? Stop drowning in your emotions. Now, I'm not saying you ignore the issue. You've got to deal with it. But when your total focus is on the problem, that's all you see. And your problem becomes so big and your God becomes so small. How many know somebody that all they talk about is their problem? And it gets bigger and bigger every time they talk about it. And they never mention God. They never mention the solution. Do not be dismayed. Stop looking only at your problem. God says, for I am your God. God says, start looking to me. Some people know more about their problems than they know about God. Some people study their struggles more than they study God. Some people spend more time meditating on the dark negative feelings and emotions and troubles they have than they meditate on God and His Word. No wonder their problems seem so big and their God seems so small. There's a law of attraction that says you move towards what you continually look at. You move toward what you continually look at. I've used this example before, right? When you teach your little one how to ride a bike, what do? You know, he's like whatever age that is, 3, 4, whatever, maybe 5, and you got that little bike, you're taking the training wheels off for the first time, you know, and steady, and you're saying, okay, Johnny, just go straight down the sidewalk, but see that tree over there? Look at that tree. Stay away from that tree. Don't hit that tree. If you hit that tree, you're going to be hurt. If you hit that tree, the bike's going to break. Can't buy you another one. Whatever you do, stay away from that tree. Whatever you look at, you move towards, you let Johnny go. And what does he do? He stares right into that tree. He's so focused on that tree. That's where he's going to end up. It's a law of attraction. You move towards what you continually look at. Maybe you're on a diet or something, you know, and you step, you look at that menu and you say, yeah, I'm going to have that diet plate, you know, carrot sticks and celery, you know, I'm just going to have that. And then you see the dessert page, you know, ooh, chocolate sundae, ooh, hot fudge, ooh. You focus more on that. You're getting calories now just by reading that thing, you know. You move towards what you continually look at. God says, start focusing and meditating on me and off of all your troubles. And then when you take action about those things, you've got a different emotional posture than if you're just engulfed and drowning in your emotions of fear and worry. Here's worry exterminator number 2. Meditate on who God is, the person of God. We talked about this last week. Check out last week's message by meditating on the names of God. How many meditated on one of God's names this week? All right, a few of you. That's good. The rest of you aren't doing anything I'm saying, but that's okay. Meditate on who God is, the person of God. God says, do not be dismayed, for I am your God. The way to stop focusing on fear is to put your focus on who God is. Put your focus on who God is. I am your God. I am your God. God says, if you're a Christian, if you're a Christ follower, God says, you belong to me. And notice the reference about God in this passage starts with the phrase, I am. How many have heard of that before, right? In the Old Testament, God calls himself the I Am, right? In Exodus chapter 3, God talks to Moses from the burning bush. Anybody remember that story? God says, I want to set my people free from the slavery and bondage of Egypt. And so God says to Moses, go tell the Israelites that I sent you. And then look at Moses' response recorded in Exodus 3:13. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And then they ask me, what is his name? What shall I tell them? God says, tell them I am who I am. This is what you're to say to Israelites. I am has sent you. And you think, isn't that a strange name for God to tell Moses? Why didn't you just tell him, you know, we'll tell him Rudy sent you. You know, it just doesn't have the, you know, what does I am mean? God is everything all the time and everywhere, so I am seems to fit. Who sent you? I am. I'm what? Everything. I'm everything. I am sent you. The great I am is with you. And Isaiah 41:10 says, God says, do not be dismayed. Do not be overwhelmed by focusing on all the negative because the I am is your God. The word God here is a name that we referenced last week. Elohim. Elohim, one of the names of God. Scholars believe that the derivation of Elohim is in the combining of the syllable El, E-L, which is one of the names for God, just El, with Eloah, which is the root word for fear in Hebrew. So Elohim literally means the God of fear. Not that he creates fear, but that he lords over fear. He is the king over fear. He owns fear. He destroys fear. God through Isaiah says, I am is with you. God, Elohim, the God of fear, the God who rules over your fear. Isn't it interesting, in this verse in Isaiah 41:10, God says, fear not, for Elohim, the God of fear, the God who rules over your fear, is with you. Isn't that great? He says, fear not. Why? Because the God that owns fear is by your side. What are you focused on? Your problem or the Lord? What are you studying more? Your stress or the Prince of Peace? What do you know more intimately? Your emotions, your fears, the negative, or the great I am? You see, your mind and heart become filled with what you focus on. Have you figured that out? That's why it's easy to get depressed after watching 6 hours of news. Your mind, your heart become filled with what you focus on. The more you know who God is, the less you focus on your problems, and the bigger your God becomes. When you receive God as your I am, you destroy the capacity of worry and fear to rule your life. Because God, the Elohim, is the God of fear that destroys and owns and rules fear. So Isaiah says, so do not fear, for I am with you, says the Lord. Do not be dismayed. Do not be looking totally at the negative, for the I am of Moses is your Elohim, the God who rules over fear. And then number three in your notes, what are the results of acknowledging God's presence and knowing who he is? Don't fear, I'm with you. Don't be dismayed because I am your God. The I am, the Elohim is your God. What are the results of acknowledging his presence and knowing who he is? When we trust in God's presence and person, he gives us three promises. In this passage, there's many promises throughout the Bible, and you just focus on your favorite. But in this passage we're looking at this morning, Isaiah 41:10, there are three promises. He says, fear not, for I'm with you. Don't be dismayed because Elohim is with you. And then he says, I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Isn't that great? He says, I'm going to strengthen you, I'm going to help you, and I'm going to uphold you. And it is interesting that before God fulfills this promise, he has to deal with the fear issue first. In Isaiah 41:10, he says, fear not, I'm with you. Don't be dismayed and looking at the negative because Elohim is your God. He has to deal with all that first. Because if you're wrapped up in your fear, you don't hear him say, I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you. Fear and faith cannot exist in the same place. One's going to dominate. You've got to decide what is going to fill you, your fear or your faith. God says, do not fear. Don't be dismayed. Then he gives the promise. And he starts with strength. He says, I will strengthen you. Amas in the Hebrew, to be strong, courageous, powerful. Resolute, to harden. Now that's an interesting definition, isn't it? To harden, to be solid. God's promise is to bring us into his power and courage and to harden us from the inside out. Isn't that interesting? To harden us from the inside out. When the pressure of life, have you ever heard somebody talk about, oh man, I'm so stressed out. I've got this going on. I got this due. I got all this. I got these deadlines and the money, this. I'm just so stressed out. I just feel like life is just closing in on me. It's just pressing in on me. Have you ever heard somebody say that? Or maybe you felt that yourself where you just feel all the pressure closing in. It's like those, if you heard of those submarines or what are they called, bathyspheres or something like that, that go deep down in the ocean. I'm not talking about surface. I'm talking about down to the ocean floor, right? These special submarines, the bathyspheres, they have to be so strong. Why? Because the deeper you go, the more the pressure is, right? And it surrounds this vessel where it's just, if there's any weakness in this vessel, you know, that's what happened to the one, was it in June, that unfortunately got crushed because there was a weakness. When there's any weakness in the vessel, it'll just be crushed because that pressure comes from every side. And sometimes life feels like that pressure is coming from every side. I remember my dad in his frustration many years ago. I was just a kid, you know, and he wasn't at that time. He didn't know God at that time. He was just feeling the pressure. And I remember he said, "Boy, if it's not the job, it's you. If it's not you, it's the kids. If it's not the kids, it's the dog. If it's not the dog, it's the bill." You know, and he was just kind of venting, you know. He was feeling the pressure on every side. God says, "I will harden you from the inside out, that nothing can crush you. I'm going to give you strength." The second promise is help, azar. Support, assistance, to render aid. Not only will God do something in us, he will strengthen us and harden us from the inside out. He will do something for us. He says, "I will help you." God is not on the sidelines of your life. Do you realize that God is at the center of your life? He wants to be at the center of everything you're dealing with if you'll invite him in. He wants to help you. He wants to provide you help with your friends, with school, with your job, with your career, with your bills, with your budget, with your family, with your relationships, with your marriage, with your health, with your mental, mental health, with your view of your emotions and all that's going on and circling around you. The word azar means to help. Azar also comes from the Hebrew zar, which is military assistance. It's coupled with the divine name. Azarel, El means God, Azar is help. Azarel means the God who is helped. Azriel, my God is my help. Ezra literally means the Lord helps. God is with you to bring you what you need. If you will invite him in by faith, he will help you. He will supply what's needed. He will give you the strength, bring you the answers, provide solutions. Have you ever been in prayer? And I've been in prayer using this very verse and saying, "God, you said, do not fear because you're with me. Don't be dismayed because you are my God. The I am is my God. You promised that you would help me. Lord, I need your help. I can't find a way through. I can't figure out how to deal with this issue at church or wherever it is. I don't see any solution here." And I would just give it to God and just meditate on the word instead of the problem. And I tell you so many times, even at that moment, let alone later that evening or the next day, I would wake up and it's like, "Wow, I just had this thought. This is the way out. And aren't I so brilliant?" That's not me. That's not you. That's the Holy Spirit bringing you the help and the solutions and the creativity you need. God is the God of creativity. He created the entire universe. You know, somebody said, and I'm forgetting the number, but, you know, those of you biologists or whatever, zoologists, you know, there's like 375 different species of beetle on the planet. Do we need 375 species of beetle on the planet? I think 373 would have done it. God, you know. As far as I'm concerned, in my house, you know, two is too many. You know, he's the God of creativity. Do you think God can't figure out a way through your problem, your relationship issue, your job issue, your career issue, your health issue, your financial bind, whatever it is? He is there to help you. So the promise is, God says, "I'm going to strengthen you and harden you where nothing can crush you. I'm going to bring the help and support you need." And then he says, "I'm going to uphold you." Isn't that great? I'm going to uphold you. Tamak in the Hebrew. That means to lay hold of, to support, to hold securely. Loved ones, when you are secure in God's hands, nothing can get to you. Isn't that good news? I'm going to hold you. I'm going to, and it literally says, I'm going to uphold you. I'm going to lift you up.
Listen, when you are burdened down, you know, think of the language we use. When you are burdened down with your problems, when you are overwhelmed with all of your issues and struggles, you know, how you doing? I'm feeling low today, right? It's all about being down. You know, I'm beat down, you know. I'm burdened down. God says, I'm going to lift you up. I'm going to lift you up where I am. I'm going to uphold you. You are safe in the palm of my hand. Last week we said in order to overcome worry, stress, and fear, to meditate on his person, his names. Keep doing that. Today, I'm going to encourage you to overcome worry, stress, and fear. Proclaim his promise for you. God says he will strengthen you. God says he will help you and provide whatever is missing in your life. He says he will uphold you and lift you up. You see, as you trust in his presence in person, he promises strength and help and his hand to lift you up. That's why God, through the prophet, said this, "Do not fear, for I am with you." Don't be dismayed and overwhelmed by focusing on your problems, because the I am, the Elohim, the God who owns fear, is with you. And he said, I will strengthen you. I will help you. And I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. That's his promise. We're going to close in a few minutes. The worship team's coming back. Let me ask you this morning, what is causing you worry today? What is causing you to be stressed out today? What is driving your fear today? What is causing the emotions of fear to wrap around you today? Your assignment for this week, if you choose to accept it, right? Dun, 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 dun. Your assignment is to choose to accept it. Proclaim God's word of promise over your life every day. Last week we said we get to know him by knowing his names. And I gave you a list of about 50 of the names of God and Jesus. Keep doing that. This week, proclaim his word of promise to you. And maybe you have your favorite promises, you know, in the Old and New Testament, whatever. You'll use those. That's fine. But there's already five right here in Isaiah 41:10. And choose one of these five, if you don't have anything else, and proclaim this promise over your life this week. You could do all five, but, you know, five things is a lot. Just pick one. Pick the one that you need the most this week and meditate. Remember meditating, gnawing on the bone, right, metaphorically? Meditate on one of these promises. For some of you, you need to be reminded this week that God is with you. You're facing that surgery. You're facing that deadline. You're facing this court appearance. You're facing whatever it is. You need to be reminded that the Jehovah God, the great Elohim, says, I am with you. You're not walking into that alone. You're not, you know, navigating the complexities of this circumstance at work or this relationship or that boss that doesn't like you. Listen, the God who owns it all, the Almighty One, says, I am with you. Some of you need to meditate on that promise. And what you do is you say, God, I feel alone, but your word of truth says you're with me. So I'm going to believe more in what you say than what my emotions say. Did you catch that? Everybody needs to grab hold of that, especially teenagers when you go on social media. You need to believe more in what God says about you than what social media says about you. I am your God. That's a promise. Some of you need to focus on that. The I am is my God. God has chosen you. Did you know that? He has chosen to make you his prized possession. You belong to me, God says. Some of you need to meditate on that this week. And then God says, I will strengthen you. Some of you, your resolve, your courage has been drained out and you're just like jello or mush or something. God wants to harden you from the inside out in a good way. And you need to meditate on it. When you're feeling weak, when you're feeling not up to the challenge, when you feel like David getting ready to face Goliath, you need to meditate on the truth and the promise. God says, I will strengthen you. See, what's so different about the gospel of Jesus compared to, like, you know, New Age thought or world thought is that we already admit it's not within us to start with. It's not about, oh, I'm a wonderful person, I'm great, I'm beautiful, I'm great at this. And you run outside and, you know, life beats you up and it says, you go back and says, oh, you already admit it's not within me. It is God's promise. But he gave it to us. He says, God, you promised to strengthen me. I'm going to receive your strength today. I feel weak, but I'm going to receive your strength. I will uphold you. Some of you need to focus on that. You see, here's the deal about meditating on the promise of God. You don't go into it feeling great. You go into it feeling whatever, weak and, you know, on your own and alone, all these things. But you meditate on the truth, and the more you meditate on His word of promise and His truth, the more it becomes real inside you. The more it becomes real in your mind and in your heart and in your thinking. As you proclaim the promise of God, it becomes powerful within you. I can't tell you how many times I felt weak and not up to the task and worried and fear about what if, and I would get a hold of God's word. I'd get a hold of this very passage and I say, God, you are with me. God Elohim, you are my God and you are bigger than anything that I face. You promised you would strengthen. I receive your strength right now, God, and you claim it for yourself. That's what the word of promise is for. God didn't give it to us because he forgot what he promised. No, he gave it to us to claim for ourselves. Whatever you're facing, whatever you're struggling with, you say, God, I receive your strength right now. And you leave that place. I can't tell you how many times I've left the place of prayer getting a hold of this verse, and I went in weak and I left strong. And nothing has changed in my circumstances, but I've changed. And therefore, how I approach my circumstances is different. Told you before, and you heard me say it again, if you're bored with it, just suck it up, all right? Is I remember the day when, as a church family, we own this building, we got a mortgage, but this is our building. And for 13, 14 years, we were struggling with different scenarios, people, and nobody wanted a loan to us, nobody wanted this, nobody wanted that, nobody, and I go into God and say, God, you own it all. You said you would strengthen us, you would help us, God, we need your help. And at the end of the day, we ended up with two of the major lenders in the entire country that lend to, you know, mega churches and school districts and government, lend to counties, were vying for our business. And God gave us a great situation. And I reflect on that all the time. I say, God, I remember those 13, 14 years. I remember those times of prayer. I remember those days when the doors was closed and people would laugh at us and nobody would loan it, nobody would be with it. And step at a time, God, you opened doors. Step at a time, you showed yourself as the Elohim who was with us. And at the end of the day, you made it all happen. That's why this is God's house. This is God's. It's not mine. It's not even ours. It is God's house. And loved ones, some of you this week, you need to get a hold of God's word of promise. It is for you. God established it. God kept, you know, the book of Isaiah, was it written 700 years before Jesus was born? Why do we have it today? God kept it today because he knew in the year 2023 that there would be believers in the Vegas Valley that need him. And the entrance to getting him in your life, in your mind, in your heart, is by meditating on the word of promise. Meditating on the word of truth. The more you believe in that and the less you believe in all of the negative dark stuff you're dealing with, the more it becomes powerful within you. You need to get with God this week and get a hold of his word of promise for your life, for your family, for your kids, for your finances, whatever it is. God says, fear not. For I am is with you. Don't be dismayed and overwhelmed because the Elohim, the God who owns fear, is with you, the great I am. And my promise to you, God says, is I will strengthen you and harden you from the inside out. No one will be able to crush you and defeat you. I will help you. I will send and supply you with the resources, the creativity, the strength, the ideas, the open doors that nobody can shut. I will lift you up and I will uphold you to a place that you never thought you could be. And that's why the glory all goes to Him, because He does it. And that's how you overcome your worries, your stress, and your fear. Let's stand together. Let's sing this song one more time. We're going to close in prayer. Let's do it.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life.
Oh, sing it to Jesus by faith now.
Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire.
Sing it again now. Sing it to Jesus.
Your name is power. Your name is healing.
Oh, it's life.
Your name is life.
Break every stronghold, Lord.
Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like.
Can we sing it one more time? Sing it to Jesus now. Proclaim it over your life now.
Your name is power. Your name is healing.
It's life.
Your name is life.
Break every stronghold, God.
Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire.
Let's close in prayer this morning. God, I thank you so much that you love us so much that you do not want us to live in worry. You do not want us to live stressed out. You do not want us to live wrapped up in fear. There's so much going on in our lives. There's so much going on in the Vegas Valley. There's so much going on in our world today that if we focus on those things, we will be afraid. But God, you will set us free. If we will agree with you and partner with you and get a hold of your word of promise and your word of life, that becomes power within us when we receive it and believe it. God, I pray for everyone in your house right now. I pray for those watching right now that are struggling in their minds. They can't get a good night's sleep because of the worry, because of the stress. Lord, show us the next steps to take, because we've got to do our part. We've got to take care of business. But God, you promise us that you will be with us. Fear not, for I am with you, Lord. Speak to that person that feels alone today and remind them that the Almighty is walking right beside them every step of the journey, that they are not alone. God, you promised us, Lord, that you would strengthen us. Lord, I pray for the one who feels weak emotionally, spiritually, mentally, physically, financially, wherever the weakness is, Lord, speak your strength, Lord, into them. Lord, I ask that you would teach us how to be people, God, that will feed on your word of life and therefore, God, receive the power of the Almighty in our daily walk. Forgive us, God, for calling out to you and neglecting your word of life and your word of promise, because that is the way, that is the vehicle, that is the design that you have set in motion for your people to walk in the power and the reality of your presence, your strength, your healing, and your life. You've given it to us, Lord. Cause us, God, to get a hold of these promises this week and to experience, God, your strength and your help and your presence like never before. That's my prayer for our church family today. I pray it all in the mighty name of the resurrected one. In Jesus' name I pray it. And if you agree with that prayer, say a big amen this morning. Amen. God bless you, everybody. Have a great week. See you next time.